side. The amount of crowd that I'm seeing over here is something which is absurd. Something which is not required. And
what is this?
Spelling?
K-U-N-T-S-C-H.
That you should know. Cross section is what shape? Why is that so?
Okay.
What is this?
I.
Are you hearing?
No, sir.
What should I do? I should say.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, this is the K nail. Also for the Kanchar nail. K-U-N-T-S-C-H-E-R. Used for fixation of fractured femur, sharp femur. Used to be used previously, nowadays not used anymore. It can be used if the patient is not affording for the nail. That is the only indication for it being used nowadays. This is the eye or the slot, which is to be kept laterally when the nail is put in, and it is used for removal. It is of clover leaf shape in cross section, which increases the stability of the implant. The mechanism of stability that it achieves is called as elastic impingement. It used to be called as elastic impingement previously. Now it is called as radial compliance or a 3-point fixation. Now what is a 3-point? That is a sort of dicey. Some people say it is the entry point with the isthmus on the distal side and the curve of the femur anteriorly. Some people say that. Some people say it is the entry point with the distal fixation. And so just mention that it is a 3-point fixation, elastic impingement, radial compliance. Kanchar nail given by Gerhard Kanchar, who was a surgeon from which place?
Germany.
G goes with G. Okay. Both of them knows everything. He should start teaching. And what else? That's it. What are the advantages of interlocks over this nail? What are the advantages of an interlocking nail? Mother, you interlock the nail, you put screws which are horizontal to the nail and going through the nail. Early mobilization is one. Second is rotational stability. This will not give a rotational stability. Rotational stability will be given by something which is locking the screw, locking the nail horizontally. So this will only give an axial stability. That too, there are chances of it coming out, backing out from the entry side. Ways of putting it are anterograde or retrograde. Either from the piriformis fossa and you go down straight away, or you go from the fracture side. You have to open the fracture side, retrograde, put it in, and then you have to backhammer from the proximal part. All that is okay. This should be, entry point should be what? Piriformis fossa or GT?
GT.
Why GT? And why not piriformis fossa? Why piriformis fossa? Why not GT? It should be the piriformis fossa because it is a straight nail. If it has to be from the GT, there has to be a lateral bend to it, which nowadays interlocking nails of the second generation have. This does not have, so it has to be from the piriformis fossa. If it is from the GT, so it will avulse the cortex medial or laterally, whatever, where it is going. So this is made up of which material? This is what?
Stainless steel.
What stainless steel?
365L.
316L. Remember that, it's 316. What are the other implant materials that you know of?
PMMA. PMMA.
What is that? They broadly classified into?
Metallic.
Okay, then what else? One is steel, one is cobalt chromium alloy which can be used. The third one is titanium, also called as TAV, titanium aluminium vanadium alloy. Remember it as TAV. And the fourth is bioabsorbable, which he has said, which are PGA, that is polyglycolic acid, or PDS, which is polydioxanone. Just remember the sort of materials, that's it. Bioabsorbable polymers or materials ka advantages kya rahega? It is bioabsorbable. So what will happen?
Less tissue reaction. Tissue reaction.
No, it is not that. Tissue reaction is more in fact with bioabsorbable. That is why sometimes it is not used. So advantages of bioabsorbable things are, you don't require a secondary surgery for implant removal. Okay. Secondly, it is radiolucent. So, doing an X-ray will not show you an implant in the middle of your fracture site, it will show you the fracture reduction properly. The disadvantages are that sometimes it causes synovitis, it can cause irritant synovitis, it can sort of causes sterile discharging sinus because of its irritant capacity. And third is, many a times it is soft or it is not very rigid. So it is said that it loses around 20% of its fixation power in the next 20 minutes of its fixation. So you can say it is less rigid or less stable as compared to stainless steel. What is this? This is a full ring Elizaro. There are various sizes that are available. 140, 120, 160, 180, depending upon the circumference of the limb, like the leg or the thigh, wherever you want to apply it, you have to measure it preoperatively and then use the ring size, whatever is there. It is either 3 ring fixation or a 4 ring fixation. And what are the various types of fixators you know of, external fixators? They are divided into pin fixators and ring fixators. Pin fixators can be further divided into uniplanar, it can be biplanar, it can be unilateral, bilateral. So it can be a combination of unilateral, uniplanar, unilateral, biplanar, biplanar, or a sort of permutation combination with that. And this is a ring fixator, it is a fixator, very good fixator, based on the principle that it causes osteogenesis either by distraction or compression. It causes increase in the osteoblastic activity at the fracture site. More so used with compression than distraction, used for limb lengthening, that is one of the things any layman would know. Plus it, other orthopedic uses are deformity correction and treatment of non-unions. And plus it has got this thing that we can do a corticotomy and we can distract it. So it is said that the corticotomy itself is a sort of a, causes increased vascularization or is a stimulant for vascularity at that particular site. So that helps in treating even diabetic infections that you don't mention in the exam, but all the other orthopedic uses you can. It is also used in fresh trauma nowadays. It is just that somebody who is good with it can use it anywhere he wants. Upper limb also it can be used. This is used along with the shanks pins that are there and wires which are used for more stability. And what else? SHANZ.
Yes.
What is this? Made up of stainless steel. Huh? Everything you remember it is made up of stainless steel. You can just mention it in the exam. And along with that, whatever the use is, just go on with it. The examiner is going to ask you, the more you mumble or the more you sort of open your mouth, the more it will be of advantage to you. The lesser you speak in the exam, it will be a sort of a thing that you don't know anything. Still, you will not flunk, that is for sure. What is this? Cannulated, non-cannulated. What is the use of cannulation? Guide wire. Now, what happens if the guide wire is passed through it? The screw is directed in the proper position as we want it. It will not vary here and there. Cannulated, non-cannulated, partially threaded, fully threaded. These are two types.
Because as it is, we are drilling the hole.
But guide wire is very thin. Guide wire is thinner than this hole that is there. That is why it goes in it. So once the guide wire goes in, we know where it is. So multiple sort of guide wire, this thing, even if you make saw per, sort of around 150 perforations along with the guide wire, only then you can think that you have perforated the cortex and you have sort of compromised the fixation. But 2-3 times, 4 times, 5 times you do it, it does not harm any time. So this is a bigger this thing with threaded screw, which is threaded and it will occupy a lot of space. So before putting this, we have to be sure that this will go in the normal direction, in the direction that you want. So it is cannulated. What is the disadvantage of cannulation? It makes it weak. It is not, it is slotted sort of, so it makes it weak. What are the types of cancerous screws? Partially threaded, fully threaded. Use of partially threaded screws.
The cancerous, you can use.
What is a lag screw?
It's a lag screw. So in internal fixation, sir, the proximal part, the proximal bone is drilled wider. So, and sir, the screw fixes onto the distal bone, and that is why.
So it causes compression at the fracture site. So you require compression in a fracture where you can pass a screw through the fracture. So any screw that should be passed through a fracture has to be a lag screw. It should not be a screw which is not in the lag screw principle. The principle is that the proximal cortex is overdrilled, the distal cortex is not overdrilled, or in this case, you can use the same drill. But I'll tell you how. There are two ways to put a lag screw. Either you can use this screw, because the proximal part is smooth, the distal part is threaded. So it will hold in the distal part, and as soon as these threads come in the sort of purchase of the distal cortex, one is the proximal cortex, one is the distal. So what is close to you is proximal cortex, one is away from you is the distal cortex. Suppose the fracture line is this. First of all, the screw has to be perpendicular to the fracture line. If the fracture line is oblique, the screw has to be perpendicular to that obliquity. Are you getting me? That is one principle. Second is, once this holds the distal cortex, this is smooth. So as you go on tightening the screws, it will cause cause compression at the fracture side, which is in the middle. This will slide now in the middle of the fracture side. This will slide and this will cause the purchase. So as you tighten it, it will cause compression over here. If this whole thing is threaded, you cannot have a sort of a lag screw principle. If there are threads all over, like from here to here, fully threaded screw, how can you put a lag screw? Like what he said, you can over drill the proximal cortex and you can see that your screw through the proximal cortex is loose, is not having any purchase. Then you can sort of drill the distal cortex and then it will tighten. So even a cortical screw can be used as a lag screw, but in that you'll have to use a bigger drill to over drill the proximal cortex and then go distally. In this you require only one drill because it is smooth. It does not require a proximal distinct to, as it is, the drill has gone, it has drilled more than the circumference of this proximal shaft. Are you getting me? So what are the diameters you know? What are the parts of the screw?
The head.
Deep is there, middle is there, beech mein kya rakha?
Shaft.
Range. Shaft ke upar kya rakha? And between the head and the shaft? So this is the head, this is the countersink, which is just under the head. Just under the head is the countersink. It is either conical or it can be concave, matlab it can be curved inside. So it is a countersink. Below the countersink is the shaft. In this, the shaft is very big. In cortical screws, the shaft is this much because the whole this thing is threaded. And what is between the shaft and the threads is the runout. Runout is a junction between the shaft and the threads. So this is the runout. Here is this. RUN-OUT. This is the runout. So it is said that the screw is weakest at the runout point. So whenever it will break, if there is angulation at the screwdriver that you might do while you are fixing it, so it will happen at the runout junction. What are the types of diameters you know of? Core diameters, outer core diameter, inner core diameter, nothing.
There is a core diameter and a thread diameter.
And an outer diameter, okay, a thread diameter.
So the core diameter is the inner part, but the thread diameter is the diameter of the outermost threads.
Okay, what is the use of that? What is the use of having a bigger difference between the core diameter?
Bigger difference will provide.
So this is the, what threads are you seeing outside? The maximum thread, so the circumference that is there, that will be the core diameter from the center measured across it. And the inner diameter is the shaft, which is minus the threads. Are you getting me? So in cancer screws, the difference between the core diameters is high. In cortical screws, it is low because the threads are flat. Na? The threads are almost sort of stuck to the shaft. So there the core diameter is small. So what is the advantage of having a bigger difference in the core diameters? Or what is that? What is the use of a cancer screw basically?
It's
exactly. So cancellous screw is used to fix bones that are cancellous. Cancellous bones are soft. Metaphyseal areas, some bone calcaneum which is cancellous. So if you want to have a good purchase, you have a screw with a better this thing. So cancellous screw is used most of the time. Tip, what are the types of tip you know of? Point tip then. With flutes, without flutes. Flute is what? Flute is just an elevation, they give it on the tip to sort of drill the screw as it is. So it will be a self-drilling or a self-tapping screw. Although you know what's a tap? What is a tap? If you want to put a screw, so you will drill the screw, then you will measure the depth of the screw as to how long the screw is required. Then you will use a tap. What is the use of a tap? Use a tap over here. It's just an instrument in the shape of a T which has got threads distally to it. Just remember that. The tap is used to sort of make threads before you put in the screw. So it builds up the threads in anticipation that the screw is going to come over there. So you use a tap before we put the screw. So there are some screws where you cannot sort of, you may not be requiring to tap it. So those are self-tapping screws. So self-tapping screws are screws which have got flutes at the tips which sort of make their own threads and you can use it without tap. Then, what else cancels? What are types of heads you know of? Types of heads? Are carpenter use karte, what is that thread? What is that sort of head type? That is a slit type, na? The screwdriver you have seen is a slit type of screwdriver. So there is just a line over here and it's a slit type of head. The other types are cruciate, which is in a cross shape. Then there is a Phillips type, P-H-I-L-L-I-P-S. Phillips type, that is cruciate shape, which is sort of shortened, which is on a short, falls short from the periphery. So it is this is the screw head. So cruciate, this thing will be there and it will not end up till here. It falls short. So Phillips used to be used as the most common thing, but nowadays what is used is the hexagonal type. Hexagonal is one of the most common screw threads that are used, screw heads that are used. And the latest one is the star drive type. S-T-A-R-D-R-I-V-E. Okay. How do you screw cancel your system? What is this? Most commonly asked, most commonly picked up, most commonly screwed up. What is this? Thompson and Austin.
Thompson does not have any holes in the shaft as well as it does not have an eye over there.
Exactly. So this does not have an eye, so what is it?
Thompson by the side has some
holes. But it does not seem to be a Thompson. I don't think this is a Thompson. This is a Austin Moore processes. Thompson has got a very big calcar. Are you getting me? This is an Austin Moore processes. The difference is that Austin Moore has got a eye which is used to extract it. Now this is the eye. What is this? Two holes that are there. So advantage is that it can be used without a cement. Types of arthroplasties. What is arthroplasty?
Arthroplasty joint patients are ME and total.
What are other types? ME, total and resurfacing. That is a new thing that has come up. You just resurface. Total is what?
The middle surface and the part are both
the what is the hemi?
Only one part of the joint is.
What will be resurfacing?
All the parts are just smoothened and the process
is
done.
Acetabulum has to be replaced. But femur ka only the surface of the head is replaced. So that is resurfacing arthroplasty. The advantage of that is you are preserving almost the whole of the normal femur anatomy, proximal anatomy. And you are giving the patient one more chance to do a total hip later on if he wants. Once you do a total hip later on, you can do a revision total hip, but that is difficult, that is complicated, that requires a resurgery which is very invasive. So you can do a resurfacing and then you can sort of do a total hip later on. It gives a sort of a buying time period for the patient to do it. So this is the eye used to extract it, and one more use of this is to hold the processes in the proper version while you are putting it. While you are putting it, you put an artery over here. Artery is the hemostat that you use in surgery also. And you put it and you sort of maintain the version. What is the normal version that a femur has, proximal femur? 15 degrees. 15 degrees. 15 degrees anti-version means if this is my femur and I have got a hemi process is done. So my process will be lying how if I am standing over here. It will be lying like this. This anti-version that the proximal femur has with the distal femur or the shaft of femur. So this antiversion has to be maintained, otherwise it will cause, this is not antiversion but it is relative retroversion. So this will cause dislocation. If it is more antiverted, it is less, so this has to be maintained. So this is used also to maintain the antiversion. The holes are used for bone growth. Then this hole only, right?
Okay.
The hole that is used for extraction is used to maintain the alignment while you are putting it. Okay, and it can be, this can also be cemented, it's not, it cannot be cemented, but you can do an uncemented in this because there is chance of bone growth. Then what is the prerequisite for this? It has to be having a calcar, sort of a, there's a neck femur fracture, there has to be a calcar which should be maintained before you put this. Otherwise you have to use what? A Thompson. Thompson is what? It is a calcar replacing prosthesis. That is a commonly asked question. It replaces the calcar, therefore it sort of brings the femoral anatomy to more towards the normal side. So Thompson is used when there is no calcar. Suppose it's an IT fracture and you want to do a replacement. That time you can do a Thompson, because IT will be below the calcar. Calcar is what? Calcar femoral. Nobody knows, but nobody is asking also.
So
when you are having a neck femur, this is the calcar femur is the strongest part of the proximal femur, where all the stresses of the proximal femur are directed, the vectors are directed in that direction. So that is why the bone is remodeled in such a manner that it has to be the strongest at that point. So the calcar here is this. It is the posteromedial cortex of the femur which is the strongest. Now if you are having a neck femur, so this will go off. This we have to remove while you are replacing it. So at least you have to have this much of the calcar remaining. Or the 1.5 to 2 centimeters of this medial cortex remaining to put an AMR. Otherwise it will not sit, it will not be strong if it sits. So Thompson is the calcar replacing if you have an IT fracture which is at this level, which is at the level of IT, intertrochanteric level. So there is no calcar in it. So in that case you can use a Thompson. So Thompson does not have holes in the stem. Secondly, it has got a very fat calcar, so you will see a very fat bulging over here. And it will not be with holes. Why it will not be with holes? Because you don't want to weaken the stem of the prosthesis. If holes are there, so it will weaken up. Any area that has got holes is weakened. You're getting it? So this you sort of, this has to be without holes, and the weight transmission will be better. So it makes it more strong. So one is Thompson, one is Austin Moore processes. What is the third one?
Bipolar.
Difference between bipolar and what is this? Tripolar or what? Unipolar.
Unipolar.
What is this? Bipolar. Now do you think that okay, it's maybe mota hai, so it can be a Thompson. So it is a bipolar with a collar. Many a times if there is osteopenia, the bone is weak, and if you want to put a bipolar, we can use this, which is with a collar. So it is a collar with a collar stem or collarless stem. So bipolar is because this is there. Once you see this, you also say it is a bipolar. Advantage of bipolar over AMR?
So it can be lived for a longer time, sir. About 15 years or so.
Okay, they said that the life of the implant is longer. So the chances of replacement that the patient might require or a revision that the patient might require are less. What else?
So decreased chances of protrusion as a
temperature.
Ah, so this movement is that what will happen?
Mobility
is more, range of movement is better, it is said. Then it is also said that this remains mobile for some years, but then it becomes fixed, or maybe a year or so, it is said. So then once it becomes fixed, so as such when you go to see theoretically in that respect, in this point, there is no advantage of AMR or bipolar because this ultimately becomes fixed at some point. So what are the other advantages of bipolar? Write it down everybody. There is a neck length which can be varied. There is a sort of a head which is over here which is detachable, and the head cut sort of under the slot is of variable length. So you can vary the length while you are putting it. So if you are getting shortening in a patient, or patient whose limb is already shorted, so you can sort of vary. That is called a modular. Modular means you can vary the sort of this thing. And
why can't it be done with the unipolar?
What? It is fixed, na? This you cannot vary, na? This is one piece. So disadvantage of AMR. It causes protrusive acetabula. Later on, few years later, if you do an AMR, you see the X-ray. It causes protrusive acetabula. That is the acetabulum. When you do a PBH X-ray, the acetabulum will be bulging more in the pelvic cavity. So this sort of weakens the medial part, the acetabulum. It is space occupying and it causes a protrusive acetabulum. Second is, it usually causes thigh pain. What is the cause of thigh pain post-operatively that the patient might be having? The proximal femur is oriented in such a manner that it is sort of convex anteriorly slightly once you go down, like you can see this. So as it is convex anteriorly, this is not an anatomical stem. The stem is straight. So when you put it, so once it goes in, it snugly fits in, but this will hit the anterior cortex or the posterior cortex. Usually the posterior cortex because it is curving anteriorly. So that causes thigh pain. So the solution for this is that you can use an anatomical stem. There are anatomical stems that are available which are in the shape of the proximal femur. Sort of slightly bent anteriorly. Bipolar,
would inserting them be a problem?
No, it is not a problem. It just touches and impinges rib. So usually if the fixation is very good and it has not loosened over the years, then it will not sort of make cause, but slight loosening and the implant not coming out straight away will at least sort of cause a wobble in the distal part. That wobble can cause a pain. What is the disadvantage of a bipolar over an AMR? This is detachable. So once it dislocates, it can be a case when this might get dislodged with the head. So if this gets dislodged with this, it will definitely require an open reduction. But you have to open the thing, see the dislocation, and you have to reduce it. Reduce this over this and then into the acetabulum. So this does not have the disadvantage because this is a one piece. So once it comes out, it will not get dislodged. If it doesn't get dislodged, so at least you can try a close reduction. But then you can sort of pull, push and whatever under CM and you can relocate it in the acetabulum. This is okay, na? This will not be good. This is sort of a V nail, which is used for the tibia, but it is not in the shape of a V. A V nail is a. It is over here. So V nail is a, it is called as a V nail because it is in the shape of a V. So it is like this. Like this. So this bend that is there anteriorly is called as the what bend? Or what angle? So the Herzog's angle, Herzog's. H-E-R-Z-O-C-S. C-K. Herzog's angle, which is 11 degrees. This is used in the treatment of tibia shaft fractures. Having a Herzog's angle. Not used nowadays because interlocks are used. Advantage of interlocks, I have told you. The interlock that the tibia has will also have a bend like this because the proximal tibial anatomy is like this. You have to have an anterior bend for the nail to go in. But Herzog's angle is still maintained in the implants, but only that it has become interlocking now. What are the types of interlocks you know of?
Static, dynamic, mixed.
Very good. Static and dynamic is one classification. What is the other classification? Reamed, non-reamed. It has to be reamed. What is reaming?
So you the medullary canal is widened so as to insert the nail so that it easily fixes it.
Exactly, that is true. Reaming is you use reamers before you put the nail. So reaming has got various advantages that it sort of provides a internal bone graft for the fracture site. Secondly, reaming will increase the contact. The amount of contact the nail has with the internal part of the bone. The disadvantage of reaming is that if the patient is come recently and has got some sort of flail chest or some chest trauma and you are reaming, so it can cause fat embolism. So fat embolism can lead to a critical stage for the patient. So many times it sets that compound fractures or fractures in which the patient's chest is not normal, you should not ream it. The disadvantage of reaming is what?
After the shape
it,
of
it
the
it decreases
canal
the
canal.
Amount of endosteal circulation that is there inside, so it causes less amount of vascularity in that thing. But it is also said that it increases the periosteal supply. So reaming increases the periosteal supply, decreases the endosteal supply, and provides bone graft to the fracture site. Makes the canal. Sort of more cylindrical because every bone has got an isthmus. Isthmus is what? The medullary part which is the narrowest. So once you ream it and you make it the widest or as wide as the upper part, you can put a nail which is of a larger diameter. As you can put a nail which is of a larger diameter, you can the fixation is stronger. The amount of chances of failure are less. What are first generation interlocks? What are second generation interlocks? What are types of cementing you know? Cement is what material? PMMA, polymetal methacrylate. It can be antibiotic impregnated or it can be a plain one. Whatever, matlab it can be just a cement or it can be antibiotic impregnated. What are the types of cementing methods that you know of? It is a first generation cementing that is with hand, that is manual. Second generation cementing is used with a gun. A gun is used to insert the cement and you do a... The cement should not go very distally into the intermedullary canal. So you have to block the intermedullary canal with a sort of a stopper which you have to put before you cement it. That is second generation. And third generation is you have to use pulsatile lavage before you insert the cement with a gun with a centralizer distally. Just remember all these words. Centralizer has to be put, has to be put with a gun. It has to be pulsatile lavage before you put it so that no blood is there and all that is gone off. And it has to be distal clogging and a centralizer has to be there. What is the plaster of Paris material that you know? What is the chemical formula?
CaS4H2O.
So that is anhydrous calcium sulfate. So if you want to harden it, what do you do? What is the reaction?
Exothermic.
What are the types of plasters you know of?
Homemade and ready-made.
One more classification in orthodontics. That has to be added in Campbell. Okay, what is? Plaster of Paris is one. Plaster of Paris with melamine resins is one. Melamine resins. Then the third one is low temperature thermoplastics. And the fourth is? Scotch cast. High or low temperature polymerization is used. So example is a scotch cast. Some blue cast that you must have seen somebody has applied somewhere. That is a scotch cast which is used nowadays. Water hardens it, polymerizes it, and it is more hard as compared to the normal plaster that you use. Chances of breakage are less. You can put full weight bearing, you can put the patient on full weight bearing right from day one without any sort of fear of that a plaster might break.
Sir, those wells which are just inserted in water and then put in that contains new plaster. Is that the same or the POP rules which are just.
That is POP, that is plaster.
Plaster
can be put as a slab or it can be put as a cast. So you want to put it as a cast to take the whole roll, dip it in water and you circumferentially tie it on the patient's lip. If you want to put a slab, then you have to make a slab with various number of plasters at the length you require. It's upper limb or lower limb or whatever. And then you have to apply it once it hardens or before it hardens. And then you have to put a band-aid. Okay, what is this? Whatever. L-shape, T-shape. What are the types? Uses what is buttressing? What are types of platings you know of? Modes of plating.
Interlocking compression.
Interlocking plate नहीं रहता है. और एक plate को interlock करते हैं. What do you have to fill in this plate?
Compression.
One is utilization plate, buttress plate, compression plate. Condylar plating. These are types of four types. Remember, condylar, buttress, neutralization, and compression. Compression you have to use when you have to apply compression the fracture side. What are the ways of applying compression the fracture side? Either you can use a dynamic compression plate which has got screws that are oblique. One screw you put centric, one screw you put eccentric, and when you tighten both together, it will cause compression at the fracture side. So that is one way of applying compression. What is the other way? The AO Muller's device, a compression device that can be used to apply compression.
You apply and then you put an interlock.
Exactly. What are the buttress? What is buttress plating? Buttress is what? What do you mean by buttress? Buttressing. I am buttressing you all so that you all don't come in the
strength.
Strengthening or supporting. So buttressing is you have to buttress the plate. Basically, the plate is buttressing the fracture so that it does not. It is avoiding a shear force at the fracture side, shear. Then neutralization, what is neutralization? Or bridging. Neutralization also called as bridging plate. just have to bridge the fracture site in order to obtain union. You cannot apply a compression at the fracture site. Why you cannot apply compression?
The deformity.
Deformity you corrected, you are applying a plate. If the fracture is comminuted, there is a sort of a wedge in the fracture site, there is a gap. So you cannot apply compression because compression will obviously cause the shaft to collapse. So that you cannot do. That is compression. What is condylar plating? You fix the condyles, that is called as condylar plating. What are condyles present in the body? Femoral condyle, lateral condyle, medial condyle, humerus, tibial condyle. Okay? What is this?
Semitubular plating.
What is called a semitubular?
It is shaped like a part of a circle. Compressed part.
So it is one third, it can be one fifth, it can be one eighth, whatever. So usually a one third semitubular plate is used. It can be used in the compression mode, but it is weak. So many a times it will fail if it is used at the weight bearing side. What is anti-glide plating? Anti-glide. One mode is anti-glide plating. What is that? Usually used in distal fibula fractures, the fracture line has to go anteroinferiorly to posterior superior. So if this is the fibula, this is the tibia, so fracture line has to go like this if you hold, anteroinferior to posterior superior. So this distal fragment will go posteriorly and this will either stay here or will go anteriorly. Or this will go anterior, whatever. So there's a displacement where this fragment is displaced posteriorly. So when you apply a plate, you have to apply the plate in the posterior surface of the fibula. So in this, the advantage is that you may not require distal screws in this. Why? Because once you apply the plate in the posterior surface, it will buttress the fragment which is displaced posteriorly anteriorly without having a hold in the distal fragment. Are you getting me? Not getting it. Anti-glide plating used in lower third fibula fractures, anteroinferior posterior superior fracture line going, distal screw is not required. Okay. What is this? L-shaped buttress uses
tibial condyle fracture.
Mostly in shear fractures where you just buttress it, you apply the upper part of tibia and you buttress the whole thing. Buttress means it will sort of compress it in the horizontal direction towards its normal location. So that shear that is coming axially will not displace the fracture site. What is, why is this screw, why is this hole bigger than the other hole?
Not to displace when you have any shear.
Many a times you have to reduce the fracture and put it. So you can put a screw over here in this hole and you can adjust the plate after putting the screw. Because you don't want the screws to go in the joint line. At the same time, you want the screws to sort of reduce the fracture at the normal position. So if you want an approximation to it, after fixing the plate, you can put a screw here, which should be in the middle, and you can glide the plate upper or lower. This will also assist the reduction of the fracture. This is one third tubular, can be used in ulnar fractures, fibula fractures. Or less stable than a dynamic compression plate or a 3.5 DCP. That you have seen, here it is not there. 3.5 DCP you have seen. It is like this only and it is flat. It is flatter, it is more thicker than this. So it is more thicker than this. So it is more stable. And the screws there like this only are oblique. So as the screw holes are oblique, matlab the slope of the screw holes are going downwards. So once you put a screw over here, you reduce the fracture, you put one screw here which is centric and then you put one screw here which is eccentric, which is away from the fracture site. So both the screws in place, you don't tighten before you put both the screws and then you tighten together one screw each time. So it is, you will see that the fracture site is compressing because once this screw ka head which is eccentric goes in and sits in the plate, so it will glide the plate towards the medial side. So that will take this fragment inside. What is this?
Reconstruction
is used for?
Ulna,
fibula, radius ring and acid doublement can be used. It can be used where else?
Patella.
In बच्चों इन पीडियाट्रिक एज ग्रुप इट कैन बी यूज फॉर वेरियस डिफॉर्मिटी करेक्शन ओके व्हाट इज दिस आई डोंट मेक इट फास्ट स्टिल मैन
EO
called as shan spins. Shan spins can be fully threaded or partially threaded, or they are half pins or full pins. Full pins are fully threaded, half pins are partially threaded. They are used for fixation of external fixators. Specialized pins like these are used along with these other fixators. And you put the rods connecting the pins. Suppose here is a fracture, so you put rods which are connecting the pins proximally and distally. There are clamps, round clamps that are there. The round clamps are S-Q-loop clamps. They are not AO clamps. So don't mention AO if you want to speak anything about the clamps. Okay? The S-Q-loop clamps, AO clamps are not there over here. Osculo-loop. Yes. What is this? We all are. Uses? What is this? The uses of a nut. Where do you tighten it?
In the external fixator,
there are connecting rods that are there which connect the rings together. The rods can be tightened on the rings with the nuts. And it can also be used to fix half rings and make it full rings. That is used over here. What is this? It is a cortical screw. Why is the cortical screw? What is the difference between cortical and cancel screw? What is the pitch?
What is the pitch?
That is important. Defined pitch. What is the lead? LEAD.
That is the distance that it travels to when.
So if the pitch is high, the lead has to be.
More.
Yes. So advantage of a high. What is this? Difference between cortical and cancel screws. Difference between cortical and cancel screws. Cortical screws have got a lesser pitch as compared to cancellous. Then you can also build a point that they have got a lesser lead as compared to a cancellous. So two points you are able. Then you can say that cortical screws are not cannulated. Usually they can be, but they are not. Cancellous screws are cannulated. Cancellous screws are used in cancellous bones. Cortical screws are used in cortical. Both can be used as lag screws. अरे मतलब पिच रहता है ना पिच हाई रहेगा ना अभी ये कैंसिलस जो इफ द पिच इज हाई मतलब ये दो डिस्टेंस तेरा हाई है ना तो अमाउंट दैट इट विल गो इन विद एवरी टर्न ऑफ योर स्क्रू ड्राइवर विल बी मोर एज कंपेयर टू कॉर्टिकल स्क्रू इसलिए कैंसिलस स्क्रू का यूज किया द थ्रेड्स आर मोर स्प्रेड दे आर स्प्रेड एज कंपेयर टू कॉर्टिकल तो द अमाउंट ऑफ परचेज दैट यू गेट इन अ मेटाफाइसल बोन इज बेटर सो ऑलवेज इन मेटाफाइसल बोन्स यू शुड सॉर्ट ऑफ यूज कैंसिलस स्क्रूज एंड इन normal cortical bone because the sort of back out strength of a cancellous screw is more than a cortical screw. That is one thing.
The bone strength is lesser. No, lead is the distance that it travels to the screw.
Spelling?
S-T-I-N-M-A-N-N-A.
Most in Sorry, from Switzerland.
SS.
The uses of a single pin.
Skeletal traction.
Brother sister of a single pin. What is it? Brother sister. How do you? Nobody knows. So, Stinman pin, the corresponding this thing is Denham pin. D-E-N-H-A-M. So, Denham pin is different from the Stinman pin in that it is threaded in the middle portion. So as it is threaded, it can be used in, or it should be used in, cancellous bones, it should be used in osteoporotic bones, it should be used in calcaneal fixation if you want, And stimulant pin is smooth, so it can be used in young patients, in patients where you want, you are putting the pin at the cortical area. So what is the use of this pin?
Traction.
Types of traction.
Skin and
advantages of disadvantages of skin traction.
Slippage
is there, sores are there, avulsion of skin is there. What else? Allergy is there. Patient might be allergic to the material of traction that you're using. Disadvantages of skeletal traction.
Pin track
infection can occur. Chronic sinuses can occur. Depressed scars can occur. There can be over distraction at the fracture site if you are applying a lot of weight. There can be osteomyelitis of the bone where you have drilled it. What is the type of osteomyelitis? What sort of sequestrum you get in that? What is sequestrum?
The necrotic part.
What is involucrum?
Cloaca. The sinus opening.
So what type of sequestrum you get in this? It will necrose the bone in that particular this thing, and there will be a sort of a hole around it. So around the necrosis will get a ring sequestrum. Okay. The uses is using skin traction, skeletal traction, stimulant pin I'm talking about. And what else? As a part of delta frame that we apply for ankle, compound ankle fractures. Remember that. Delta frame that we apply for stabilization of compound ankle fractures. It is used as a part of that. We apply the external fixator and we fix this pin in the calcaneum along with the sort of shank pin around it and connecting rods and clamps. So that is one use. Other use is what are the, where else it can be used? Sometimes in central fracture dislocation of acetabulum, you reduce the head intraoperatively and then you can fix this. So three uses I have told you. Dynam spin ka no specific use, only uses that it is used in osteoporotic bones and cancer
acetabulum
and in KOR.
Subcutaneous traction.
Prolonged stimulant pin traction or skeletal traction can also cause stiffness of the joints, adjacent joints. This clamp we're talking about. External fixator clamp. You've said which type, AO, escular, testicular. Usage of SM. A clamp is used to fix the shank pins with the connecting rods. The shank pins will go in the bone, you will fix this to this, and then there are holes above this which will connect the rods. This is used to fix the shank pins to the connecting rods in an external fixator. Okay, clamps, that is the only use. ये वो नहीं है, ऐसे क्लैप है। तो क्लैप का तुम टाइप बोलने मत ना। एग्जामिनर में एग्री में नॉट एग्री वैसा। जस्ट इट्स अ एक्सटर्नल फिक्सर टू क्लैप। यूज़ टू फिक्स दिस टू दिस बस।
सो व्हाट इज़ द डिफरेंस
शैंस पिन है। शैंस इज़ गॉट थ्रेडेड वन एंड ना। मैंने कहा था मेरा जो रिक्वायर टी हैंडल फॉर दिस बट इसका थ्रेड यहाँ पे है अंदर है ना बोन के इट इज़ यूज टू नहीं नहीं ये नहीं है बाहर का मतलब शैंस पिन विच इज़ आउटसाइड
So in the exam is out, just because it's protruding only on one side.
Because there are threads inside which are born in the bone and then increase the purchase of this thing. If there are no threads, so stimulant pin, there is a sort of a disadvantage of stimulant pin that as it has no threads, many a times if it is used chronically and the track gets infected, so this will become loose. So it slides here and there. So this cut is disadvantage, but it is used for temporary skeletal traction. You want to operate the patient. It is not that it is a temporary sort of definitive fixation. But we want to, by the time we operate, we want to at least, what is the advantage of giving skeletal traction? Why do you give it?
Providing
bivolar fracture, I will say okay, I will not walk, but why give traction?
The union between the fracture ends is maintained.
So it sort of decreases the chances of soft tissue contractures. It decreases the muscle spasm, it also decreases the pain. And the fourth is, it helps in fracture reduction. Suppose you admit a patient today and you don't operate the patient for the next 3 weeks. If you don't put skeletal traction, the distraction will not be there and a sort of soft tissue contracture will cause the bayoneting of the fracture sites. So that reduction, when you want to stretch it, once you take the patient in, it will not stretch because soft tissue contracture will inhibit it. That is the use of skeletal traction. Okay. Skin traction, the uses can use in what? Where it is used?
Up past, dip.
basic questions are not going very deep, so don't get irritated, but it is required.
The PIV is used
intertrochanteric pelvic fractures.
It is used in neck femur fractures, where it is called as Buck's traction, B-U-C-K apostrophe S traction. Then it is also used in cases where there is some effusion of a joint and you want the joint to be immobilized. You are giving bed rest to the patient and you want the joint immobilized, so you give skin traction and tell the patient to rest. उसमें knee effusion भी आता है, hip effusion भी आता है. Sometimes used, it is said that patient might be having a FFD. What is FFD? Fixed flexion deformity, where the knee is not extending to its limit and there is some soft tissue spasm or hamstring spasm that is there which is avoiding it. So that you can use. So these are the uses. What is this? Splits, you are not asking the example. Splits. Thomas Sprint and all that. यहाँ पे कुछ नहीं पूछेंगे. You'll be out of the exam within 2 minutes. Don't waste your time. Read surgery more than this. All this. This you can read in 10 minutes also while you're coming. Don't sort of prioritize your. This is what.
Deep plate.
T plate also called as Ellie's plate. A double L is whatever. A double L I apostrophe S. Used for fixation of distal and radius fractures. Acetabular fractures, it can be used in cases of anterior column fractures. Just write it down. Anterior column fractures, distal and radius, you have to talk first. Distal and radius, intra-articular fractures, okay? Which are communicating with the joint, you have to do an open reduction and then fix it. Extra-articular colis and all, you can just put a cast and send the patient, so that gets reduced. But intra-articular fractures, young patient has to be fixed open. So for that it is required. It is just that an Ellie's plate does not have a curve that this plate is having. So I exactly don't know what is the curve for. It cannot be used for the TBR. It can be used for, I don't know, 4-year-old, 5-year-old TBR, but it is so small that people will fix it. So you can see it can be, sir, as the curve is there, I would also like to consider that it can be used for upper tibial fractures, but as the bone size, as the plate size is small, it is less likely. So this is the only set you will get in the exam. No new instruments you will get. Nobody will do the effort of getting new instruments. Very simple sharp on both sides, then only it is a Kirchner wire. If it is blunt on one side and sharp on the other, it is a guide wire. The use of a guide wire, as I told you all, it is used to put a cannulated screw. This is such a thick wire that is used for a DHS. DHS, dekha tumne na? Dynamic hip screw plate. That you see. So that screw that is there, that is cannulated. That is a very big screw. So that big screw, it is a big guide wire, or sort of thick guide wire. Usually guide wires can be thinner also, depending upon the screw size that you want to put. There is a guide wire, a Kirchner wire is sharp from both the sides. Uses of Kirchner wire, spelling of Kirchner wire. Uses of K wires, personal wires,
used for wrist fractures in
where?
Radial.
Example, just enumerate.
Patella fracture.
Wrist, matlab you are talking about cartilage, you are talking about distal radius, or you are talking about
ulna.
Radius ulna. Radius ulna you can use, but then in bachus you can use as an intramedullary distinct. But commonly you say distal radius fractures where cross K wiring can be done. Metacarpal fractures where intramedullary it can be used. Proximal humerus fractures it can be used. as a part of TBW. What is tension band wiring?
For patellar fractures,
olecranon fractures. So it's not bothered. What is tension band wiring principle?
You approximate the.
The principle is that you convert the distracting forces into compressive forces. So that you at a site where the muscle is acting and it is distracting, you put two K wires which will act as a rail, and along with that you put a stainless steel wire which is a TBW, tension band wire, around it. So when a muscle is contracting, it will contract, which will cause distraction at the fracture site, but your fixation will in fact compress it. So the compression will increase the osteoplastic activity that will help the fracture unite. So the places where a tension band wiring is used: malleolar fractures, patellar fractures, olecranon fractures. Okay, the prerequisite for a tension band principle to work is that you should mobilize the patient post-operatively, because the muscles have to act. If the muscles are not acting, there will be no force to sort of counteract it. So if there is no reaction, there will be no sort of contraction. Then the other prerequisite is that the opposite side of the fracture fixation has to be intact. So it's a patellar fracture and this is the fracture line. So you are applying your fixation over here. So the opposite side of the fracture site has to be intact. Otherwise it will sort of bend in that manner. So the opposite cortex or the distal cortex should be intact, write it down. You should mobilize the patient as soon as possible. That is another prerequisite. That's it.
So what is figure of 8 banding for patella?
So along with the K-wire that you put, you apply a figure of 8 distal. So you take the tension band wire, the stainless steel wire, which roll rehta hai, roll, uspe wire rahega pura, lapeta hua wire rahega. So that is the stainless steel wire, which you use in this along with K-wire. So you sort of make it round and you apply it in a figure of 8 distal. That will serve as a tension band principle. So malleolar fractures, olecranon fractures, patellar fractures, greater trochanter fractures. That's it. What is this? Don't take it home, huh? Yes. That is a K-wire, that was a guide wire. K-wire is sharpened both sides. Uses bata diya tumko. Guide wire ka uses bata diya.
Sir, jo case diya jayega, will we be asked like the examination of joints?
So always when you say the diagnosis, make it complete as possible and as elaborate as possible. So if it's a right-sided osteomyelitis tibia mein proximally or that, or chronic or acute, so you know osteomyelitis can be acute or chronic. So you have to mention it's a right-sided proximal tibia, acute or chronic osteomyelitis with no distal neurovascular deficit. Just mention that word. No DNDVD. DNDVD, no distal neurovascular deficit. In a this much year old patient who is currently disabled, just say if the patient is disabled, not disabled, or what the patient what problem is having. Disabled with limping, shortening, discharge, infection, pain, not able to carry out his daily activities. So utna thoda line bol dene ka. Something you will moment and then he'll ask you one or two tests, that's it. Clinical examination, I don't think, but you all be totally go down because of that. Implants are thoda bol.
Sir,
DHS का X-ray ना, X-ray देख लेते हैं, लेकिन
ये
but implant I should have now, or something I should have to tell you what it is. So if this is serrated in the middle, the dynamic pain, if it is not serrated, the stimulant pain. That is recognition of implants, I think you know now. DCP is like this thing, which is not curved. It is not whenever you take a plate in your hand, where is the plate one? So if it is not semi-tubular, it has to be a DCP. So common use of dynamic compression, DCP is what? Dynamic compression plating. Most commonly applied principle of orthopedic internal fixation. So it is flat, in cross section it will be flat, it will be thicker than this, it will have oblique screws, oblique slopes of the screw holes that are there, and used for radius fixation, ulna fixation, fibula fixation. Sometimes 4.5 DCPs are used for tibia shaft fixation also, not usually recommended. Interlocking nails are recommended. Then humerus fractures. Sizes wise to nahi puchte na, 4.5 DCP, 3.5 DCP. Why it is called a dynamic? Two types of compression plating are dynamic and static. Static matlab it will fix the fracture site, and with the mobilization or with the physiological muscle forces there will be no compression that will be acting. Dynamic is when the patient starts walking, the normal pull of the muscles will cause a compression force. You just remember that why it is called as dynamic. Dynamic hips too, I'll tell you once I see the x-ray. Bones to all will read, I think, na? Bone mein to anything people can ask me if they want to ask me. Identification. Ye kya? Ye? ये लिगामेंटम पेटल है. दिस इज द लिगामेंटम पेटल है. हियर विल बी द क्वाड्रिसेप्स. दिस इज द फीमर. दिस इज द टीबिया. दिस इज द टीबियल. मीडियल कॉन्टाइल, लैटरल कॉन्टाइल. दिस इज ऑल दैट इज देयर. एंड अटैचमेंट्स आई डोंट नो व्हेदर दे विल आस्क फॉर नो. एडैप्टर ट्यूबरकल इज अ वेरी फेवरेट क्वेश्चन ऑफ ऑल द एग्जामिनर्स. इट इज प्रेजेंट पोस्टीरियरली ऑन द मीडियल एस्पेक्ट ऑफ द फीमर. The prominent that is present, what are the insertion side, insertion of muscles or at the adductor tubercle? Yeah, aapke kya aage quadriceps rehta hai, medially vastus medialis rehta hai, laterally vastus lateralis rehta hai. That's it. Three muscles attached over here on the medial side of tibia. SGS. Okay, SGS. Anterior to posterior, what is the order? Semi tendinosus is most prominent. But you can feel it.
Sartorius gracilis.
Exactly. So it will be more posterior, na? Because it is most prominent. So remember, it is sartorius gracilis and this all this. Read all this. Attachment of muscles.